Simple is better. Less is more. Making food that's understandable, without complications, I think is the way to go. I feel flavour should be individual and have their identity, but when mixed with other components of that dish, it creates the overall impact that we are trying to achieve. Test Kitchen is a reservation-only restaurant. We seat maximum 22, 20 comfortably, and we change the menu kind of whenever we feel like it, whenever we get new ingredients, new inspirations. Sometimes it can change within the day. Other times we'll keep a weekly menu, but change it constantly throughout the week. We serve a tasting menu, so we do 6 courses, which kind of end up around 8 to 9 courses because we throw in some dishes there which aren't listed on the menu. We explain every dish and we want guests to, you know, feel comfortable here, and guests can be relaxed and can spend as long as they want here. Horrendously interactive. Partly because you're right around the kitchen. So you're only a few, I think the largest space between the diner and the kitchen is 4 feet. We encourage guests to come up to the pass and see what we're doing, ask questions. You know, there are no secrets. We want them to understand what we've done to the dish. And if they want to replicate it, we'll happily give them the recipe, or at least tell them how we made it so that perhaps they can replicate it in their own homes. There's no boundaries. It's completely open and transparent. I mean, we have a lot of return customer bases, which makes it even more stressful because we need to make sure that their experience from their previous visit to the visit that they're going to be making is exceeded. Not just expected, but exceeded. That's the challenge.
First came to Test Kitchen about a year ago. I came with some friends and I was really blown away. I had some preconceptions about what the food might be like, and I didn't know Josh then, but I'd heard about the place, I'd heard about what he had done before. I had an idea in my mind of what I was going to be served. But then what really came when I had the meal, I was really blown away. It was something really quite different from anything I'd had before. And I actually don't remember what we had that night, and that's a good thing, because you don't want to remember just one dish that stands out or one particular thing. You want to have the memory of an experience of having food just come to you, and you have this impression of a perfectly aged ham or a perfectly cooked bit of fish. These are little highlights in what is more of an experience of being immersed in someone else's imagination of what food should be, of what a meal should be.
I love Josh because you never know what he's going to cook for you. I know that for the Test Kitchen, it depends on what ingredients he has for that day. I've been to Test Kitchen for more than 5 times, and each time, he cooks something different. Because again, it depends on what ingredients are available.
We don't write any recipes here in the Test Kitchen. And here at the Bistro Group, because we create dishes so quickly, we want to do it on flavor. And there is no way for us to do that, to write a recipe on that. It depends how we feel on the day, to be honest. You know, some days we might want something a little bit more sad because it's hotter outside, so we need guests to feel a little bit more lively. You know, changing recipes on a daily basis is impossible, so we'll just rely on our palates that way. There's hardly any repeats. So within the week, we kind of keep the backbone of the recipe, but we can stray away from that as much as we want. I have a book, and we'll write down every menu that we do every night in that. And I said when we open the place, we're not going to repeat any dish until we've reached its 100th service. From the 100th service, we can go back on the book and look at the dishes that we've done. It's been interesting, because we opened last year, Feb last year, and I see all the initial dishes that we did to what we're doing now. It's nice to see the evolution that we've kind of achieved in that process, but we didn't realize it. It's only now that I look back on it that, yeah, we've actually evolved quite a bit to what we've become to today. So now that I look back on recipes and I can repeat a few of the recipes from before, I think, yeah, we'll repeat this, but we'll do it differently now because we've learned along the way. how to do things better.
People like Chef Josh because he can make any ingredient into something wonderful. For example, like for heirloom rice, you'd think just make it into like, cook it into like a normal rice and it's a side dish. You know, when you go to his restaurant, he mixes it with ice cream. It's for the texture. Suddenly there's like a popcorn texture and it's heirloom rice. One time he made a lollipop made of heirloom rice. And you know, whenever I ask him, what do you call your dish? He goes, I don't know. When it's there, I just make it. He always thinks out of the box. It's not like, okay, heirloom rice should only be cooked like this. It's like he's pushing himself. He'll think, what can I do with this ingredient that's not normally done?
We try to keep to a weekly menu, but I'm impatient. I need to keep my mind stimulated. So if there's a new ingredient that comes in, I'm quite happily scratch that off the menu and create a new dish. And we're produce driven, so each dish is derived from the actual ingredient. So it's not like we have to rely on classics or certain cultural preferences. Here we look at the ingredient first. What's going to go well with the ingredient? And then we create what we call a triangle balance out of three ingredients. Triangular balance is our blueprint on creating dishes. So three is our magic number. Three is my favorite number. We'll take three ingredients as 3 points of the triangle. Those 3 points of the triangle represent an ingredient, also a flavor profile, whether that be sweet, salty, sour, umami, bitterness. We'll elect three of those that coincide with the ingredient. The challenge is to get those three ingredients balanced to the center point of a triangle. But take note, the distance between the center point is different from this end to that end and this end to that end. So we have to be very smart in where we actually place sour, sweet, salty, bitter, whatever we may be using during that creative process. But as long as we feel that balancing point is in the center, then we've got a dish.
I think he's very complex. I would agree that he doesn't overcomplicate things just for the sake of making things more complicated than they should be. I don't think we should underestimate how much thinking goes into every component of what he does.
I used to create dishes using a bubble method, and it's quite a common method for chefs to use that, where you'd start with one single ingredient and bounce off ingredients that would pair with it. But when you build on a flavor library inside your head, you realize that the possibilities are endless. You can literally mix any other flavor, as long as it's paired well with something, into a dish. So you could have 1,000 different ingredients into one dish, but that's too complicated. We wanted to strip it down to its bare essence. If we could create a dish with two ingredients, even better. If we could create a dish with one ingredient, even better. But we feel that three gives the right balance. It gives the guests the thought power to think about what we've done, and also the options for us to really be creative. I never wanted to be a chef. You know, I saw how much my mom worked. My mom, she's a remarkable woman. She's a restaurateur at heart, and she would buy restaurants that were failing. She would go in, create a new concept, and sell it. Create goodwill and then let it go. And she did this with multiple different restaurants. It was constant. So we never really had a home-based restaurant. For her, it was more of a business to open, create, sell. I've inherited that impatience of opening restaurants and, you know, not that I'm going to let go of them, just that I want to continuously create new restaurants and open them. It's an addictive thing that is quite dangerous. It was kind of like a natural progression for me to go into the trade, but I didn't go the normal way of culinary school. I kind of went the hard knocks way. Even though I did enroll into culinary school, I kind of left after a while. I just couldn't take it anymore. So it's been a continuous journey ever since then into different people's restaurants, learning, and I've ended up here today, back home in the Philippines. First restaurant was Restaurant Alchemy in Boracay. It was very small. We had 15 seats, and we did something that we kind of coined island cuisine, in a sense. It was modern, you know, I was full of all this knowledge and hype from Scandinavia that I wanted to do something different. And the island at the time, back in 2010, was still underdeveloped in a way from a culinary standpoint of view. It wasn't oversaturated. we did what we thought the island needed, and it worked. We gave locals as well as tourists this new cuisine where it was modern, it was fresh. Everything was sourced from within 60 kilometers of the restaurant. We took advantage of the ocean and we took advantage of the farms in Kalibo. And from there, we were able to create a small menu. It wasn't extensive, but it gave guests the options to have all different proteins and different dishes. And it did very well. We got into the Millie Guide top 500 within a few months of opening. You know, Boracay is a challenging place to live and work. It's seasonal. During the low season, that was the hardest time for us because guests weren't really coming towards the beach to go and eat. In 2011-12, the island changed. It became more party zone area. Me having a restaurant of 15 seats with high ambience points prior to those change in events, I lost the ambience. You know, there was music from the left, music from the right, one playing techno, the other one playing reggae. I was kind of distraught. My little paradise was getting destroyed. It was almost a stroke of luck that the Bistro Group called me. And I said, what is this about? We need somebody to come in and introduce new dishes to the Bistro Group. We're looking for somebody young and vibrant, and we're hoping that you could fill the position. I said, yeah, okay, I'll sign a 6-month contract. And I joined them, and I haven't left ever since. It's been 6 years now. In 2012, we had 9 concepts and around 32 stores. And currently now we're at 17 concepts and 74 stores, so we've expanded quite a bit. So coming from fine dining and then getting immersed into casual dining is a big difference between the two. It was a learning curve. I had 6 months to do it. These were all rules that I never pertained before. I would go to the market, get some ingredients and create a dish. Here is so many different steps in order to create. And luckily there was a corporate chef existing when I moved into the company. And I thought, great, there's two of us, you can help me out, I'll help you out, it would be fun. So I was thrown into the deep end, where I had to learn from scratch. But luckily, you know, the Bistro Group is a very supportive company in the way that they nurtured me, in a sense.
Josh's main day job is as an executive chef for the Bistro Group. And I think there's no time when you're doing something as a corporate chef when you feel, how could I do this if I had free rein, or if I could do this in an artisanal manner, or if I could do this for customers who would really get it and understand what I'm trying to do. And I think he's very lucky in that he was given the opportunity that very few other chefs have to actually put that into practice and make a restaurant out of it.
I love baking bread. It's therapeutic. It's a daily duty for us. You know, when we come in the mornings, first thing is to do bread. Test kitchen, we change the bread daily. Again, we don't have a recipe for it. It's all down to how it feels. I come in the morning early to do it. It's quiet, it's peaceful. You know, it's one of those dishes that we still make with our hands. We don't use a mixer. It's a very harmonious product to make because you're feeling for moisture, you're feeling for gluten, you're making the stretch, you're working the dough. And then by 5 o'clock when we start cooking the bread, you actually see what you started with and, you know, you try it out. And every day it's different. It's never the same. And that's what intrigues me about it. It's always different. We have a very small team. We have Mikey, who's my right hand, Paolo, who's my left, Melanie, our dish master. And then, of course, we have two servers. We have Trisha and we have Rossell. Because we're such a small team, we're with each other every day except Sundays. Everyone knows what their roles are, everyone knows what their jobs are. But now, because we're expanding, you know, I'm sending some of my team members to different restaurants now who's going to be opening the restaurants. So Paolo will be leaving us to open my next one, Savage. Mikey will stay here with me until we open our third one.
Working with Chef Josh is definitely a big learning experience for me. This is my first job. He teaches me a lot of things, not just with the techniques, how you see things, how you perceive the flavors, the ingredients, the dish altogether. He has a different way of approaching food. I've worked with other chefs before and with him it's different. You look at it and it's simple, but then you taste it, it's a whole nother thing.
the team and I, we're all together all the time. You know, there's never a free moment. Yeah, they are family, you know, honestly. It's like, I spend more time with my kitchen team than I do with my actual kids and my partner. Even though I love spending time with my team, it's like, it's getting on my nerves now. I'm gonna go home and spend time with my kids and family. But I like it like that. We're all working for the same goal. The goal is undefined though, that's the greatest thing about it, is that we don't define goals, we just want to make sure that we all walk in the same direction. And I hope that we continue like that and nobody frays off to a separate direction. Because if we can maintain that pace and maintain that direction, the world's our oyster, we won't stop.
I also appreciate working with a small team. Since we always work together, we work closely together, is that the bond grows like really well. So we always try and teach each other new things. And the fun thing with Chef Josh is that he lets us play around as well. So whatever you want to do, try it, go for it. And as a cook, it helps us grow.
Prime is very crucial to us. If it's not prime, we will age. Ingredients all have their own prime point. Take a tomato, for example, or tomato. You can pick it green. You can pick it going towards red, or you can pick it red. But what is the standard? What's the prime of that? There is no particular standard for a tomato. You can use a green tomato in salads or raw perfectly. You get this lovely acidity to it. For us, we don't mind using green or red, but is it ready? Is it at its prime? So if it's green, it needs to have this beautiful rounded sourness, not a spike sourness. So we'll wait.
So most of our meats that we serve here, we dry age ourselves, we cure for ourselves. Chef Josh believes that time is an ingredient as well. We take time, so we get quality ingredients. We either have local or imported, and then we cure them, or sometimes we just salt them, keep them in brine. So we have this tuna roe that we just cured. It came from a local farmer's market, and then it was really nice. It is big, so we just put it in brine. It's actually hanging now, and yeah, we play around with meats a lot. I remember we got kangaroo meat before, we got ostrich, ox heart, beef cheeks, a lot actually. He likes playing with different meats, and the flavors, the aromatics he uses for curing really comes true. That when you taste it, when you dine in Test Kitchen, it's just a pop flavor.
One of our proudest moments is our curing process. We like to preserve and we like to include time as an ingredient. So there's some ingredients that we have that are 8 months old already. It's something on the dish, it's very minimal, just the smallest amount that we use. But the process that's gone into it has taken months, that it will become underappreciated on the table, if not explained correctly. But it's an integral part of creating the overall flavor. Same goes for our fermentations. We pride ourselves a little bit on that because we take an initial start flavor, let time take its process, and it transforms into this phenomenal rounded richness that was nowhere near apparent in its first stage. So we enjoy those, we're proud of those. How do I keep creative? Constant push to be creative. Creativity doesn't just come, it's not natural. You have to really try to be creative. And I hate those people who aren't actually creative. Cooking is, we don't just touch an ingredient and magically turns into a dish. That doesn't happen. We have to have a thought process behind it. And I think the constant push to create dishes keeps me creative. If I hadn't joined the Bistro Group, I could see myself still being in Boracay, but not really knowing how to run a restaurant. What the Bistro Group has been able to teach me is that there's so much more to a restaurant than just cooking. And I'm very grateful for the Bistro Group to have given me that. Now I sit in the Test Kitchen, and without that knowledge that I gained from them, this wouldn't be possible.
Josh's strength as a chef is that he really knows his customers. He knows how much they're going to be willing to take, how much he can push the envelope. He knows how they're going to react to things. He'll do just enough to dazzle you, but he won't go overboard where he's going to alienate the customers, as some chefs do, and give you the impression of, well, this is supposed to be good, so I have to enjoy it. He keeps the menu grounded, but at the same time, because of his years of experience, he is very competent. So he can execute almost anything that comes into his imagination.
The Test Kitchen kills my creative urge. It gives me a way to let it out. I still get impatient. I still can't learn out of a book. I still have to work with my hands. I still have to do it in person. The Test Kitchen helps in that way because I can physically do it. I can physically kill my boredom and my intrigue that way. But of course, there's always going to be something that's you know, scratching at my neck and thinking, what's next, what's next, what's next? The Savage is going to be our next project. Because of that itch, I didn't want to create something like the Test Kitchen. It needed to be the opposite of what I'm doing now. And I was thinking, the only way I could do that is to change the cooking method. So we decided to go pre-industrial, which means no gas or electric. Everything had to be done in wood, charcoal. And it's a very human way of cooking. It's going really back to the roots. We didn't want any blenders or anything, so it's a little pestle and mortar. We're challenging ourselves more than we're challenging the restaurant community. This is our personal challenge that we want to achieve, and we'll see if it takes off. When I was given the opportunity to open these restaurants in this location, I thought long and hard. I have the Test Kitchen, I'm very happy with the Test Kitchen. And I automatically knew that I wanted to open this pre-industrial restaurant, so I wanted to challenge myself more than anything. But then I had this small little area downstairs. It's not even maybe 30 square meters that I didn't know what to do with. And I thought, well, I could create the alter ego then to Savage and go full technology downstairs and have no technology upstairs. So downstairs, I'm opening a place called Helm. Helm is very intimate. It's only 10 seats. So it's going to be fine dining. So I have the best of both worlds, one where I can be primal and the other one where I can be a little bit more sophisticated. The food culture in the Philippines is, I feel, at its absolute and utter prime. In the past 3 years, maybe four, we as a Filipino, we've become more cultured in a sense. We've been able to travel outside of the country more. We've been able to experience other cultures, trying different people's foods. We're more discerning customers now, which is stepping up the game for all restaurants in the Metro Manila and nationwide. It's a nice moment to be in because everyone's trying to do something different. We're not stagnating. Everyone's trying to constantly push to get a newer level. That's an exciting time to be in right now. The Test Kitchen, it perhaps is a reflection of myself. It's a confused concept, but at the heart of it, it's really defined. I'm sure there's going to be connections between all of my restaurants and myself. It's inevitable that a little bit of me goes onto them. If I planned out my future, I might get depressed if I didn't follow the path. So without defining where we want to go, I think it's easier on me as a person, and easier on those who are around me, you know, because nobody wants to see me depressed, and I don't want to get them depressed either, especially my team and my family. So let's not define anything, let's just keep pushing. What comes, you know, let everything be a surprise.